to 5 o'clock in the morning, we all practice walking meditation. Walking meditation is not a luxury. In order to still be yourself, to find ways. And finally, at 4 o'clock, we get the idea. He said that we have to go to Philip Gasso. We have to ask him to intervene so that we can stay 10 more days to wind up the operation. And then we were out at 5 o'clock, but there was no taxi. And the embassy will open only at 9 o'clock. They were not in a hurry. They didn't have 1,000 more people to take care of. So he had more time to do walking meditation. And then we were there at the gate of the embassy when it opened, and we went in. And we talked to the ambassador, and he wrote a letter to the government of Singapore, intervening in our favor, asking them to allow us to stay 10 more days to wind up the operation. And then we wait until 11 o'clock to have that letter. Yes, almost 11 o'clock. And we run to the office of the Prime Minister, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. And when he got the letter, he had to convene a meeting of all the cabinet members. And we were waiting outside. And finally, they said, yes. They said, we should go right away to the Ministry of Interior, to the police headquarters, and had our visa renewed for 10 days. We had only 15 minutes in order to go there because the deadline is drawing close. Because before that, they said that you go to the airport and before you climb into the plane, we give you back your passport. So we went through this kind of situations. And we know that if we don't have a spiritual dimension in our life, we will be lost. So dear friends, when you come here, you are not seeking for social, political support, because there is a tendency to speak about your suffering, your difficulties, so that you can get more people supporting you in order to fight the other side. That is a big temptation. If you are strong, you have more supporters, the other side will have to die, to withdraw. And that is the hope of many people. But we know that that kind of activities have been going on for many, many years. It have not brought any fruit at all. And Plum Village has a very different kind of approach. That we should go, we should have a real peace process. We should have a real roadmap for peace. And it should be based on our spiritual strength that is lacking in our leadership. So if you can bring peace into yourself, if you can bring solidity into yourself and your group, you may be able to influence your government. And together, you can propose something that is that could be accepted. And that something is not just a treaty, a peace treaty, written only in political terms. And military terms. The peace treaty in Plum Village is entirely based on your spiritual insight. And people who come to Plum Village, they always sign a peace treaty. you sign a peace treaty with yourself because you may be at war with yourself. War is inside. You are making war to your body. You don't know how to take care of your body. You have made your body suffer a lot. You have destroyed your body with alcohol, drugs, and other things. Now you have to sign a treaty with your body. You have to sign a treaty with your feelings and emotions, your fear, your anger. You should know how to go home to you and to take care of your anger, to take care of your despair. You have to make a peace treaty with them before you have some peace, before you can reconcile with your beloved one. If there is war in you, it's very easy to start a war with your beloved one. Not to say your enemy, because your beloved one can be your enemy, everyday enemy. The way you talk to her, the way you act, full of anger, full of violence. You are making yourself into an enemy. You are making your partner into an enemy. How can you hope to have peace in your country and with the other group? And that is why to sign a peace treaty with yourself and to sign a peace treaty with your beloved one is very important. In Plum Village, we have the text of a peace treaty. And many couples have come forward and signed a peace treaty in the presence of the whole Sangha. Dear one, I promise that from now on, every time I get angry, I would not say anything. I would not do anything. I would not be tempted by the desire to punish, because I know punishing can only make you suffer. And if you suffer, you make me suffer. And if you can practice the peace treaty within yourself, if you can practice the peace treaty with your beloved one, and then there is hope. But if you cannot practice the peace treaty among yourselves, how can you make a peace treaty with the other group that are highly suspicious of you, that hate you so much? Father and son have to reconcile, have to sign a peace treaty. That is a practice, an everyday practice. Dear one, I promise that from now on, I will not water the seed of anger and jealousy in you. I really promise. I promise only to water the seed of joy, understanding, and happiness in you. Please do the same. You know that I have a lot of anger, a lot of jealousy. Please don't water the seed of jealousy and anger in me every day. If you do, I will suffer, and you will have to suffer with me also. And this is a practice, not a statement. We all have the seed of wisdom in us. We know that punishing will lead nowhere. And yet we are always tempted to punish. When the other said something and did something that make us suffer, we want to punish her, to punish him, because we believe that punishing him or her, making him or her suffer, we get a relief. There are times when we are lucid, we know that this is childish, this is ignorant. Because when you make the other person suffer, she will try to get a relief also by punishing you back. And there is an escalation of punishment. And if you cannot stop that course of escalation between you and your beloved one, how can you stop that course of escalation with the other group of people, with the other